Greetings, students. Mr. Little here, and today we're going to talk about Africa, India, and the Arab world in the interwar years, conferences, congresses, and communists. Now, it goes without saying that talking about half the world's population over the span of 20 years in a single presentation, probably not going to get to everything, but I'm going to do my best to talk about big picture changes and big picture features. So by the end of this presentation, you should be able to answer the two following questions. How did self-determination struggles in the interwar years represent both continuities and changes from earlier resistance movements? How did both national and transnational ideas of community influence the struggles for self-determination and vice versa? How did the struggles influence the ideas? And how did economic factors shape the struggle for self-determination across Afro-Eurasia? So we're going to move around a lot during this presentation. If you'd like to double check the geography of where everything is happening, feel free to come back and refer to this map. As I said before, I'm going to try to focus on some big picture stuff. So let's quickly go over some of the big picture stuff I'll be addressing. Features of this era of the colonial struggle for independence, the resistance against imperialism, have a number of commonalities. For example, international cooperation and organization, that is, organizations and groups that transcend national boundaries or state boundaries in order to build solidarity against an imperial power or an imperial practice. The flip side of this coin is increasing nationalism domestically, that is, building a popular base and convincing the broad population to take part in an active resistance against imperial powers. And this is going to be really critical, especially in several key areas where there's traditionally been a very diverse population that has not seen itself as having things in common with other groups in that area. There's also the global influence of other revolutions. In particular, the Mexican and Russian revolutions have a great impact and serve as a source of inspiration on many of these movements. Although these places that we're going to talk about today were not independent, so to speak, they often advocated for many of the goals that the Russian and Mexican revolutions had advocated for as well. And they sought to organize people along those lines. And it was a mostly nonviolent age of resistance. That's not to say there wasn't any violence, and we are going to talk about violence, but it's notable how this particular chapter in resisting imperialism is mostly nonviolent, instead using strikes, tax evasion, and community organizing as a means of generating resistance. The interwar years in most history classes focus pretty closely on fascism and the Great Depression, and those are important features. But if you take a slightly broader view of the world from 1919 to 1939, you'll find it was awash in social, cultural, and political movements. And let's take a look at some of those right now. So part of understanding this particular chapter in resistance to imperialism involves remembering that the colonies have played a great role in World War I. For example, in Africa, in addition to the fact that large parts of East Africa were devastated via the guerrilla fighting between and the British and the Belgians and the Portuguese on one side and the Germans on the other, thousands of Africans, in addition to being soldiers, were also conscripted as laborers and porters, which may not have put them directly in harm's way, but nonetheless was disrupted their livelihoods. And in one case, even led to an uprising known as the Chilembwe Uprising, which several British officials were killed. In serving as soldiers in particular, Africans were given a level of autonomy and agency that some of them had never experienced in their lives, having grown up in an imperial system. British India was a similar situation, where 1.5 million South Asians served in the British military in some capacity. Although the British made no guarantees about some sort of home rule or independence after World War I, the fact that they did not even grant some sort of concession to the Indian population or give it some sort of acknowledgement of its thanks for their participation and their role in British victory angered many individuals in South Asia. And the war brought about some economic changes. So, for example, in order to produce weapons to fight the war, the Defense of India Act was passed that for the first time in over 100 years allowed weapons to be produced in British India. However, the need to keep food prices low to feed the army, farmers in British India were hurt by these artificially low prices. And this led to a great deal of resentment. This sort of gets at the arguments about the impact the British had on the Indian economy. The British colonial administration in South Asia was required to purchase complex and expensive machinery from Great Britain. And while this kept the British economy afloat, it was very expensive for the colonial administration, who had to usually pay for these things in silver. And this resulted in a large metallic drain out of India during this time. So the war brought about great changes that are going to set the stage for some of the things we're going to see in Africa and India in particular. So you might remember, as specifically as it applies to South Asia, the Indian National Congress from back in Chapter 32, that collection of civil servants from the British administration, as well as university-educated elites, who were the driving force behind the movement for home rule in what is now India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh. However, they were not a popular party. They were not nationwide. They didn't have roots with the common people. They were sort of a lawyer's club, if you will. However, over the course of the 1920s, they gradually widened their base by reducing or eliminating fees to be a member of the party, allowing for the election of members versus their appointment, also removing caste-specific positions. They also established learning centers across the region and allowed for local languages to be used at meetings versus simply having all meetings conducted in Hindi. All of this together helped to promote a sort of Indian nationalism that hadn't been there previously. And this can be seen in the image of Mother India. And you can see here on the right a magazine from 1909, which literally shows India as a mother with many children. I've often said I find it really fascinating that India is a single country, considering its long history of being divided amongst different cultural groups and different politics. But that is a testament to the power of nationalism. And although initially the Indian National Congress had been pushing for home rule, not full independence, by 1929 they had officially broken with the idea of home rule and pushed for total and complete independence and non-cooperation with the British. Much of this could be accredited to one man named Mahatma Gandhi. Now, Gandhi was a British-educated lawyer who had actually been living in South Africa during the war years. And it was there, however, that he formulated his idea of Indian self-rule, which he called Hind Swaraj, which not only meant self-rule for the people of South Asia, but also a complete rejection of what he believed is Western civilization. You can argue whether rejecting Western civilization is a good thing or a bad thing. It is a reminder that people of the region were acutely aware of the technological impact and the economic impact imperialism had on their lives, not just the changing of borders. Now, while Mahatma Gandhi became very popular, and arguably so, he was the icon of Indian independence, there were individuals in the Indian independence movement who did not believe in rejecting everything that Western civilization had to offer. Most interestingly, the famous poet Rabindranath Tagore, who didn't believe that India should become a self-absorbed region and should work for the welfare of the world, as well as the future leader of an independent India, Jawaharlal Nehru, who was a socialist and was not in favor of rejecting everything the West had to offer. Nonetheless, despite these small disagreements, Gandhi's tactics of satyagraha, or nonviolent resistance, and I'm only talking about one aspect of it, it's a very complex philosophy, was popular and effective. He had pioneered this tactic amongst Indian laborers in South Africa, what he calls active nonviolent resistance, walking into the face of danger and refusing to fight back, taking the moral high ground away from your opponent. And upon his return to India in 1915, one of the first places he helped put this into effect was a group of Indian Muslims called the Caliphate Movement, who were trying to put pressure on the British government to protect, or at least not actively destroy, the Ottoman Caliphate as an institution. Britain was victorious in World War I and was occupying parts of the Ottoman Empire at the time. Gandhi would then turn his attention to a textile boycott, again referencing the understanding of how British economics had damaged the Indian economy, as well as a salt march, in which he marched to the sea with a number of his followers and simply gathered salt, which is a form of tax protest, which was a form of protest against unjust taxes, tax evasion. These movements put a lot of pressure on the British to make some sort of concession. And eventually they did. They formulated the Government of India Act in 1935, which had a lot of parts to it, but it was rejected by the Congress Party because at this point they were pushing for independence, not simply home rule. However, this rejection did have the unintended side effect of antagonizing the All India Muslim League, which was another party, except this representing particularly the interests of Muslims in British India. The rejection of this bill antagonized them in part because it had set aside a number of seats for Muslim representatives. This furthered a small but growing rift between Muslim leaders and larger Congress Party leaders about the direction that a future independent India should take. And of course, it was not just Gandhi and the Indian National Congress that were pushing for some sort of independence or recognition of rights in British India during this time. I mentioned in one of my previous videos the farmers' revolts and farmer strikes going on in Bengal. There was also a very unique movement of a group of people that are known as untouchables, also known as Dalits, who are the lowest caste in the social religious caste system that's prominent across the region. And they were led by a man named B.R. Ambedkar, who's going to eventually go on and write the Constitution of an Independent India. But he starts his movement demanding rights for his group known as the Dalits or the Untouchables. So it just goes to show you that India is indeed awash in social and cultural movements demanding greater self-determination on both a national and a local level. Let us turn our attention now to Africa and talk a little bit about Egypt, which managed to win its independence during this time. So you might recall the British had been occupying Egypt since 1882. During this time, one of the growing sources of resistance and resentment at being occupied by Great Britain was a class of individuals known as the Ifindi. This refers to journalists and university students who were becoming a core of a national movement within Egypt to resist the British. Now, while a series of protests in 1906 had eventually led to a very weak constitution in 1913, Egypt's independence movement really came to a head in 1918 when an activist named Saad Zeghaloul, and I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, formed what is known as the Waft Party that was going to go to the Paris Peace Conference at the end of World War I and ask Woodrow Wilson and ask the convention to advocate for Egypt's right to self-determination as it not have the British occupying them. However, the British denied them this right and exiled Zeghaloul to Malta, and then later onto the Indian Ocean. This rejection and exile of this particularly popular leader led to wide-scale revolts and protests all across Egypt in 1919. And it was this opposition to the British, combined with, at the time, popularization of ancient Egyptian artifacts amongst the common people, that led to a form of Egyptian nationalism that was now in direct conflict with the British occupation of Egypt. So untenable was the situation for Britain militarily that in 1923, it tacitly acknowledged Egypt's independence and withdrew its troops from all of Egypt except for the Suez Canal Zone, which it would hold on to for another 33 years. However, as part of their withdrawal agreement, the monarchy that Britain had upheld and promoted for so long was going to have to stay in Egypt. Even though Saad Zeghaloul returned from exile and his Waft Party became one of the first governing parties of an independent Egypt, the continued occupation of the Canal Zone was a source of discontent among many young Egyptians. And out of this discontent emerged two very different parties. One was called the Muslim Brotherhood, and the other one was called Young Egypt, both of which came about in the 1920s. Now, the Muslim Brotherhood was a party that advocated Islamism, or an application of Sharia law to everyday life in a modern state. In some ways, a version of what Jamal al-Din al-Afghani was advocating for, only with an increased emphasis on rejecting not only Western culture, but also Western technology, something Jamal al-Din al-Afghani had not advocated for. The other group, Young Egypt, in reference to the various young parties, such as the Young Ottomans, were a socialist-based nationalist party. And I think it's really interesting because Arab socialism and Islamism are going to be in a sort of tug of war across the Arab world up until the 1980s, are going to be two of the defining political ideologies in the Arab world going forward. And I think it's interesting that one of the first independent Arab countries in the region, you have two parties at the same time representing these two ideas. Let us shift to the Middle East, the former Ottoman Empire in what is now the Middle East. So after World War I, the Ottoman Empire's territories in the Middle East were given over to the League of Nations, which then created a mandate system by which they would be administered until they were ready for independence, specifically by Britain and France, who you might also remember had agreed 2 years before the end of World War I to divide up the territory between each other in the secret Sykes-Picot Agreement. Perhaps this is the reason why most Arabs in the region did not view the mandate system as anything more than simply a continuation of the old imperial system, since it was pretty clear Britain and France already had imperialism on their minds. Now, these were not the only states being formed at this time. It's worth noting that at this time, the House of Saud in Arabia, with British support, conquered the other states of Arabia and became the state we know as Saudi Arabia today. Of the kingdoms that Saud conquered included the House of Hussein Ali, who the British had promised a unified Arab state during World War I in order to get his support to fight the Ottomans. So the territories were carved up into a number of small mandates, one in particular that's going to have long-term consequences going forward, and that is the Mandate of British Palestine. Now, Palestine is a strip of territory along the eastern Mediterranean. It comes from the old Roman name for the territory of Philistine. But during World War I, again, before it had been determined that any of this territory was going to be given to Great Britain, an official in the British government named Lord Balfour, in an attempt to gain Jewish support for the British war effort against Germany, produced the Balfour Declaration, which, among many things, said that the British government would make an effort, or at least not oppose, the creation of a Jewish homeland in Palestine. Now, you might remember from Chapter 28, the Zionist movement, which began to grow in Europe in the 1880s, specifically wanted to create a Jewish homeland somewhere. And so the Balfour Declaration was exactly the kind of thing they had been looking for. They supported it enthusiastically. And after the war, large numbers of Zionists from mostly Europe began moving into British Palestine, so much so that the region's Jewish population doubled between 1914 and 1939. That's not to say that Jews had not already been moving into the region long before that. However, Jewish migration to the region during the period of the Ottoman Empire was much less than it was during the British mandatory period. However, in 1939, the British would issue what is known as the White Paper, which strictly limited Jewish migration into Palestine at perhaps the worst possible time, coinciding with the rise of Nazi Germany and the outbreak of World War II. The reason why the British had issued the White Paper, which strictly limited Jewish immigration to Palestine, was in part the backlash against this from Arab nationalists and the rise of Arab nationalism across the region, which again, also, like Jewish migration to Palestine, had predated World War I. It was kicked into high gear by fighting the Ottomans during World War I and the potential promise of a unified Arab state. To most Arabs living in the region, especially those living in Palestine, these new Zionist settlers who were coming into the region and creating their own independent farming communities known as kibbutz, simply looked like more of your standard European settlers. There wasn't really this understanding that Jewish individuals were being persecuted in Europe. And even if there was, there probably wasn't any sympathy, since a lot of the land that these Zionist settlers were purchasing, were settling on, was either being purchased from absentee landlords who didn't even live in the region to begin with, or might have been appropriated from the Arabs living there. Arab nationalism also sought to find heroic figures from the Arab past. And one of the ones they settled on was the Muslim leader Saladin, who had defeated the Crusaders and recaptured Jerusalem. Now, the funny thing about Saladin is that technically he was a Kurd. He wasn't an Arab, but he led an Arab state and he led Arab armies against an enemy of the Arabs. And so Saladin became a symbol of Arab nationalism across the region. One of the great watershed moments of Arab nationalism came in 1926 with the great Syrian uprising against France in the territory of what is now Syria. What's unique about this is that the territory that was French Syria and is now the contemporary state of Syria was a very diverse area. It had large numbers of Sunnis, Shias, Christians, and Druze. But in this great Syrian uprising against the French, all of these groups came together in their united opposition to French rule. And this is considered a watershed moment in the history of Syria as a state. And so within the Arab world, we see the rise of two competing nationalisms in the wake of World War II. Let's talk a little bit about increasing nationalism across colonial Africa during the interwar period. While there did continue to be direct resistance to imperial rules, such as the Rif Republic, which was a confederation of nomadic peoples against Spanish rule in what is now northern Morocco, and the Senussia movement, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, against the Italians in Libya, both of these movements were eventually defeated, and the much more effective resistance was not direct military resistance. So for example, in Nigeria, during the Great Depression, there was an outbreak of civil unrest, which historians have called the Women's War, because it mainly involved women. And in particular, it involved one woman named Nwanyarua, who is at the center of this whole thing. Nwanyurua had been accosted by a tax collector in the employ of the British Imperial Administration, who had demanded to know how much property she had so he could tax it. She argued that in traditional Igbo society, widows, that is women without husbands, were exempt from taxation. However, she was then physically assaulted by this particular tax collector. After this, she rallied a number of women in her area, and they all undertook the Igbo tradition of sitting on tax collectors across the region. Now, I don't mean literally sitting, but I mean shaming and harassing, and sometimes destroying the property of tax collectors until they resign or make right their transgression. And this, again, was a reminder of the social impacts that colonialism can have on a society. You might remember the Queen Mothers of the Ashanti. One of the demands and one of the concessions the British gave to the protesters of the Women's War was to allow women to be part of the tax collecting agency. This act of resistance is widely considered by historians to be a turning point in African nationalism, specifically in Nigeria. And pushback against imperial rule could be found in the form of labor strikes, not just tax strikes. So, for example, two large strikes that took place in the 1930s would be the Copperbelt Strike in what is now Zambia in southern Africa, as well as the cacao grower strike, which took place in Ghana in 1937. In both of these cases, large African laborers who were extracting or cultivating valuable imperial resources refused to accept the meager price for their products or the meager pay for their work and organized to strike, demonstrating their ability to gain concessions from the imperial administration. This prompted a great deal of local nationalism, as well as organization of labor movements for future activism. And I say local nationalism in part because the cacao grower strike in Ghana is part of their national history curriculum, and it's described as a turning point in Ghanaian history. So this particular event will become a seminal rallying point for those who are seeking to push for Ghanaian independence. One of the interesting facts about the cacao grower strike in West Africa is that it received support from a number of organizations that promoted Pan-Africanism or were associated with Pan-Africanists. So Pan-Africanism is often somewhat misunderstood and is simply a movement to politically unite all of Africa under one government or under one ruler. And while that may be the objective of some Pan-African movements, Pan-Africanism is not just a political, it's also a cultural, social, intellectual, economic movement. And it spans across not just Africa, but also the African diaspora. Probably the broadest and most effective definition I could give you would be it is a global network to advocate for and to improve the conditions of Africans and members of the African diaspora. And the roots of Pan-Africanism go back to a man named Edward Blyden in the late 1800s, but it would really have its day in the 20th century. And the thing about Pan-Africanism is that it actually begins outside of Africa. Scholars have described it as beginning among the exiles, that is amongst intellectuals, thinkers, labor organizers, and philosophers that are in the United States, in Europe, in the Caribbean. And this is in part because Pan-African organizations within Africa themselves would have probably been squashed by imperial powers. Nonetheless, these exiles could create networks of communication, create and distribute publications to spread information, as well as create meetings in which leaders from around the world organizing and working with members of the African diaspora could come together and share information. So one of the things you do have to know for AP World is about the five Pan-African conferences that took place between 1919 and 1945. At the very first Pan-African conference held at the same time as the Paris Peace Conference, it was a relatively small conference dominated by African-American intellectuals such as W.E.B. Du Bois, and it only pushed for home rule for Africans, not full independence. But as the meetings went on, the leadership and the center of attention shifted away from African-American intellectuals and towards African independence leaders. By the fifth conference, held on the eve of the end of World War II, not only were the majority of attendees independence activists from Africa itself, but there were a number of future leaders of African states, such as Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana, and I believe Jomo Kenyatta of Kenya. Not only did they argue for independence, they also took aim at a number of other issues, such as the growing apartheid state in South Africa. And so while Pan-Africanism is known for its political leanings, it also makes its way into the cultural and artistic sphere through something known as negritude. Negritude, much like Pan-Africanism, is a movement across the diaspora. And while its definition is broad and somewhat complicated, it's essentially the promotion of Africanness in all its forms and all its functions and features in art and literature. That is to, in a way, reverse the cultural damage done by imperialism, the idea that European and Western ways were superior to African ways, sort of reclaiming that cultural identity by putting Africanness in popular art. And so one person who did this really well was Amir Césaire, who also wrote Discourses on Colonialism, which I highly encourage you read if you'd like to know a little bit more about how colonialism affects everyday life of the colonized and the colonizers. But he wrote in French, being from French Martinique in the Caribbean. He wrote Una Tempête in 1969, which was essentially a remake of Shakespeare's The Tempest, except set in a post-colonial Caribbean society. And so this sort of taking popular culture and remaking and reinventing it with an African element is one way, in addition to simply the creation of more art that promotes and shows off African culture, African history, and what it means for someone to be African or a member of the African diaspora. This is somewhat similar to what some of the leaders in Latin America, in particular Brazil, were doing in the interwar years, that is promoting a new sense of identity through providing patronage to certain art forms, specifically samba in Brazil. Now, if you'd like to pause the video and have a look at this, I've created this little chart with some of the more prominent Pan-African leaders and the organizations they either founded or were associated with and the region which they operated in. So you can see that Pan-Africanism was a broad movement that spanned the entire African diaspora in the Americas and the Caribbean, as well as Africa itself. And in many ways, Pan-Africanism truly represents the international nature of anti-colonial struggles during this time. I've done a separate video just on Pan-Africanism. I'll go ahead and link it in the description below if you'd like to check that out. In addition to Pan-Africanism, there's also one organizing body that plays a really big role in international anti-colonial struggles during this time, and that is the Communist International, or the Comintern, which was active from 1919 to 1943. Now, this was funded and sponsored by the government of the Soviet Union, so it would be fair to say that it was served as a mouthpiece for the Soviet Union abroad, and it did officially have the goal of promoting international communist revolution. While many of the leaders resisting imperialism, and who would later go on to lead their nations after independence, did not embrace wholesale communism, they nonetheless participated in Comintern activities and took part in the Comintern itself. And that is in part because the Comintern was a source of information, a source of strategizing, and a source of funds distributed to communist parties globally. And it wasn't just communism as well. The Comintern explicitly stated that they were to, quote, provide direct aid to the revolutionary movements among the dependent and underprivileged nations in the colonies. So it's true they did want a communist revolution, but they were also directed by the Soviet Union to assist anti-imperial struggles in the colonies. One of the Comintern's associated bodies was the League Against Imperialism, which met in the years leading up to World War II. The League Against Imperialism was a meeting point for anti-colonial activists to discuss tactics and strategies, as well as organize resistance activities. One of the earliest acts of the League Against Imperialism was the Hands Off China campaign, which collected money and relief for the new nationalist government in China, which was under threat of war from the United States and Great Britain, as the nationalist Chinese government was threatening to take over the foreign litigation that the Europeans and Americans had access to since the Qing dynasty. The League Against Imperialism rallied massive protests in European capitals, as well as in the United States, and sent thousands of dollars in aid to the new Chinese government. But perhaps nothing represents the international influence of communism and communist thought at this time quite like Manabendranath Roy, or M.N. Roy, who's a Bengali revolutionary who traveled to Europe, learned about communism, joined the Comintern, and then helped organize communist parties in two different countries, both in Mexico and in China. And while he would eventually move away from communism, his activities worldwide demonstrate the international nature of communism during this time. It's not just limited to the Soviet Union. They are actively assisting many anti-colonial movements across the world. However, I say all of this, and I'd like to provide a caveat to kind of close this out on, which is that we should remember that similarities does not indicate an A to B cause. So, for example, Pancho Villa, during the Mexican Revolution, in the territory in northern Mexico he controlled, he often redistributed land, much in the way that Russian revolutionaries would. And he was once asked by the American journalist John Reed, "Do you know what socialism is?" And Pancho Villa responded by saying, "Socialism? Is that a thing? I only see it in books, and I don't read very much." So Pancho Villa didn't necessarily need to read the works of Karl Marx or Friedrich Engels to understand and to see the suffering of the people he was working with. And it's a reminder to not get so caught up in the history of the world that we sometimes see connections where there might not be any. Doesn't mean there aren't connections, but it's always important to put them in their context. Think about the Haitian Revolution, right? It's true that some leaders of the Haitian Revolution during the Atlantic Revolutions were without a doubt influenced by the ideas of the French Enlightenment, but most Haitians were slaves fighting for their own independence. In the same way, Pancho Villa was fighting to build a future Mexico he wanted to see, and if it happened to be along socialist lines, that didn't really bother him, but he would never have declared himself a socialist. If you'd like to know more about any of the topics I've presented here, I do have a few books I can recommend. First off would be The Discourse on Colonialism by Amir Césaire, which provides excellent insights into the daily life of colonized peoples and the colonizers. But there's also three other books that I've consulted for this presentation, including Sources of Indian Tradition, Volume 2 specifically, is a list of primary source documents that covers Indian history from the decline of the Mughal Empire to today, as well as The Darker Nations by Vijay Prashad, which covers the international nature of anti-colonial activism, mostly after World War II, but there are several chapters, including one on the League Against Imperialism that are from before World War II. And if you'd like to learn more about Pan-Africanism and transnational African movements, I would recommend From Toussaint to Tupac, which is the Black International Since the Age of Revolution. It's a collection of essays on various topics. I want to sincerely thank you for joining me. I hope this has been informative and helpful. You should be able to answer those three questions from the beginning of the presentation. My name is Mr. Little, and I'll see you next time.